Now finally, we can build a regression model and see what's the best predictor of grad students' happiness at the beginning of the week two session. So we'll go down to linear regression here. For our covariates, we'll enter lighting, we'll enter wall color, and we'll also enter happiness at time one. And then our dependent variable, the thing that we're trying to predict, is people's happiness level at time two. So when we run the regression, here is what we find. I'll expand this so you can see everything all at once. So we find, all right, we have significance here. That's a good sign. Now let's dig in a little bit more and see what we find. So we'll go first to lighting. First is intercept, which is just if we exclude all of these covariates or we exclude all of these predictors, what happens? Is there any significant trend going on without all that stuff? That's what intercept says. So the intercept we find is not significant, so there's no really discernible trend going on here. All right, so now let's look at lighting. We go across and, hey, look at that, 0.041 for the p-value, which means that lighting is in fact a significant predictor of happiness at week two. Now if you're thinking back, what did we find earlier? We did the independent samples t-test on happiness of week one, which was significant, with a large value of Cohen's d. And then happiness of week two, we found that lighting was not a significant predictor because p is 0.082. So that is not significant at the 0.05 level. And then the Cohen's d value of 0.55 is medium, according to Cohen's guidelines. But here, when we do the regression, all of a sudden, lighting is a significant predictor of happiness of week two. So when you do a little bit different test and you have different correction procedures that the program itself is doing, all of a sudden, something that wasn't significant earlier with a different test, now it's significant here. So again, that should make you scratch your head and start to think about what's going on here. Why do we find this discrepancy? And how much do p-values really tell us if it tells us one thing one time and a different thing in a different case? So lighting, as it turns out, according to our regression model, is a significant predictor. So how about wall color? Was wall color a significant predictor time two? No. If you recall from when we ran that, p is 0.257. That's clearly not significant. Here, p is 0.835. That's clearly not a significant predictor. That's not even in the same ballpark. So wall color doesn't provide much predictive power for whether somebody's going to be happy week two or not. And now let's go down to happiness and go across, ooh, that big T value of 11.91. That should tell you that's automatically going to be significant. And in fact, P is less than 0.001. So we would conclude that lighting and happiness in week one are significant predictors of somebody's happiness at time two. So if we can't really make somebody happy in week one, then at least we can put them in natural lighting so that they feel a little bit happier in week two. So So when you go over to these options here, you can change these so you can add lighting to the null model, to that intercept, and then just evaluate, all right, how much does lighting add? How much does wall color add? You could say, for example, oh, well, wall color doesn't add anything significant, so let's just add that to the null model, and then we'll look from there, we'll look at lighting and happiness, and so on. So you can change these things around if you want to. Under the statistics tab, you can check off R-squared change. You can look at the descriptives, which here we're looking at different values, so lighting condition, wall color, happiness level. So the descriptives aren't going to tell us a whole lot in this instance. You can get part and partial correlations, confidence intervals. So you can do all sorts of different things there as well. These options, this allows you to change your criteria if you want to. So you can set your alpha level to 0.01 instead of 0.05, or you could walk it back a little bit and do a 0.10, for example, or you could use F value as your cutoff criterion as well. And then assumption checks. This will be helpful here to see if the assumptions of the regression model actually hold. So if I look at residuals versus predicted, it's going to create a scatter plot here. So residuals are just the degree of error between each individual point and the line of best fit. So I can check some of these, residuals versus dependent. The QQ plot of standardized residuals can be helpful as well. Here we go. So if all of these points fall on the line, then you have no violations of your assumptions. Here, if you look at this plot, they're pretty close. They're all pretty close to that line. So that's indicative that we probably don't have any serious violations of our assumptions of the test. So the regression model is actually useful. Here, we can rely on these values, that there's not anything unusual going on that we have to correct for here. So that can be very helpful, particularly for correlation or regression, but you should always be checking your assumptions for no matter which test you do, whether it's a t-test or an ANOVA or whatever. Statisticians would be very angry with me if I told you that it didn't matter to check your assumptions. All right. So, what do you take from all this? That's the most important part, is what is all of these different tests that we've run, what do they tell you? What do they tell you about happiness of grad students? What do they tell you about how much grad students want to go to a statistics seminar over the weekend? The interpretation is really the most important part of this whole shebang, because the whole point of statistics is to tell us something about the world, is to tell us something that we can generalize and try to draw conclusions about college students, about Americans, about young people, about humanity in general, whatever the case may be. The whole point of running these statistics is not so that we can show off how much we know and run all these fancy equations. The whole point is to get understanding about how the world works, how the mind works. So, what does this tell us about the mind? What does this tell us about happiness? What does this tell us about graduate students?